Welcome to another session of Water Technology. Today we'll look into breakpoint chlorination, which is one of the disinfection methods in drinking water treatment. Before we move on, subscribe for more informative videos. If you like the video, please click the like button and drop your comments. At the end of the session, you'll be able to enumerate the various disinfection methods, explain the combined and residual chlorine, define the breakpoint chlorination. We'll see what are the surface water sources, because we use a lot of surface water sources for drinking water treatment. Rivers, lakes, ponds, flood runoff, dams and reservoirs form the most important surface water sources, which we have already seen in our previous video. If you haven't watched, you can watch the drinking water treatment. There are some requirements of drinking water. It should be free from odour, colour, taste, dissolved objectionable gases, and pH about 8, and its TDS should be less than 500 ppm, and it should be free from toxic impurities, and it should not be turbid. But most of all, we are interested in this part, that is, it should be free from pathogens, that is, disease causing microorganisms like bacteria, virus and protozoans should not be present in water. But there are a lot of contaminants present in the surface water, floating matter, suspended matter and colloidal matter, and finally the microorganisms. After removing all these contaminants from water during our drinking water treatment, the final stage is the disinfection method, where we remove the microorganisms. We look into various disinfection methods. Disinfection is nothing but to destroy the pathogens, that is, disease-causing microorganisms like bacteria, virus and protozoans. There are a lot of disinfection methods, one of which is very widely and commonly used worldwide is chlorination. Bleaching powder, chloramines or liquid or gaseous form of chlorine is used for chlorination. In all the three cases, the hypochlorous acid is the most important disinfecting agent here. Now we look into only the liquid or gaseous chlorine. When it is mixed in water, it forms hypochlorous acid and HCl. Here, the hypochlorous acid form deactivates the enzymes present in the microorganisms and destroys the microorganisms. Here, once this hypochlorous acid is formed, it depends on the pH of the water. At pH 7.5, hypochlorous acid and hypochlorite ion are in equilibrium. Both act as a disinfectant, but hypochlorite ion is very weak disinfectant when compared to hypochlorous acid. So we prefer hypochlorous acid to be present. So we try to maintain the pH less than 7.5, that is at around 6.5, which is automatically maintained because HCl is formed. We need not reduce the pH. Next comes the ozone treatment, where the nascent oxygen which is formed acts as a disinfectant. It's a powerful oxidizing agent and also destroys the germs. And ultraviolet light, especially the 254 nanometer ultraviolet light, damages the nucleic acid component, that is RNA and DNA present in the microorganisms, and it also destroys all the other pollutants from industries and industrial solvents, etc. We are going to look into detail the chlorination process. Here it's very important because there is no hard and fast rule where we can say that this much amount of chlorine can be added into the water in order to act as a disinfectant, that is to kill the microorganisms, that is bacteria, virus and protozoans. We actually need to find out the breakpoint chlorination, where beyond which the chlorine added is going to act as a disinfectant. So why this is very important is the water, even after treatment to remove the colloidal matter, suspended matter and all other impurities, there are some impurities in the dissolved form where it can be reducing compounds, organic compounds and that is nitrogen compounds. When these reducing compounds, organic impurities and nitrogen impurities are present in the water, the chlorine cannot freely act as a disinfectant to destroy the pathogens. That is, first when the applied chlorine, you can see in this graph, that is applied chlorine is in the x-axis and residual chlorine in the y-axis. Here, as we apply the chlorine up to A, we see that there is no residual chlorine present. That is, if reducing compounds are present, first the chlorine oxidizes these reducing compounds and the chlorine is consumed. So it is not going to reflect as a residual chlorine. So we don't have any residual chlorine up to A. Beyond A, up to B, we see that the line curve increases. That is, there is residual chlorine as there we increase the applied chlorine. Applied chlorine is nothing but the chlorine added to the water. This is because the formation of chloroorganics and chloramines, that is the organic impurities and amine impurities, nitrogen impurities like ammonia, urea, etc., form chloramines. This formation is going to reflect as the increasing free residual chlorine in this graph, that from A to B. This we call as combined chlorine, because the chlorine is in the combined form, that is chloroorganic and chloramines. It is not free residual chlorine. So this part tells us that the chlorine is in the combined form up to B. Beyond this, when chlorine is added, this chloroorganics and chloramines are destroyed partially. That is, it is destroyed. So the combined chlorine is slightly reducing up to D, up to the point C. This we call as breakpoint chlorination point, because we assume that most of the reducing compounds, organic impurities and nitrogen impurities are oxidized, and further increase in the addition of chlorine is going to act as a disinfectant to kill the microorganisms. So this is free residual chlorine beyond C. Beyond C, this part only is going to act as the disinfectant to kill the pathogens. So it's very important for us to identify this point. Here you can see that all the chloroorganics and chloramines are not removed. So partially they are destroyed. So the curve is not coming down, but it's staying here. So this part is the combined chlorine and this part is the free residual chlorine. And the total chlorine here is the total residual chlorine. You can determine the total residual chlorine and free residual chlorine. When you subtract the free residual chlorine from total residual chlorine, you can determine the combined chlorine content. Actually, the chloramines also act as a disinfectant, but the power of this disinfection is very less. It is 40 to 60 times less than the free residual chlorine. So we definitely require the free residual chlorine to act as a disinfectant and ensure that all the pathogens are destroyed. So we can define breakpoint chlorination as a point where all the impurities present in the water, such as reducing compounds, organic compounds and ammonia or urea or nitrogen compounds, are oxidized by chlorine, and the chlorine added further, that is beyond this breakpoint chlorination, acts as a disinfectant to kill the pathogens. So we are just going to summarize the graph. Up to A, chlorine reacts with the reducing compounds. So there is no chlorine, no residual chlorine. A to B, chlorine reacts with organic impurities and nitrogen compounds like ammonia to form chloroorganics and chloramines. So we call this as combined chlorine, because chlorine is not present freely as chlorine. It is in the form of chloroorganic or chloramines. And if you look at the chloramines, it's not just monochloramine. That is, ammonia, when it reacts with hypochlorous acid, it forms monochloroamine, which further reacts with hypochlorous acid to form dichloroamine, which further reacts with hypochlorous acid to form trichloroamine. Here, when it goes to trichloroamine, it is very dangerous because it's toxic, as well as it gives a very pungent odor, and it gives a very irritating odor and we are not comfortable to drink. So we need to further add chlorine in order to convert this to nitrogen gas so that the complete nitrogen compounds are removed at this stage, and further addition of chlorine acts as a disinfectant. So B to C is partial destruction of chloroorganics and chloroamines, and C is the breakpoint chlorination, which we have already seen. All the reducing substances, organic impurities and ammonia are oxidized, and further residual chlorine acts as a disinfectant to destroy the pathogens. Beyond C, that is total residual chlorine, which includes free and combined chlorine, which acts as a disinfectant to kill the pathogens. Here it's very important, especially in swimming pools, because breakpoint chlorination is not only useful for water treatment, it is also useful for swimming pools, because in swimming pools the swimmers actually incorporate a lot of nitrogen compounds into the water, because the more the number of swimmers, more amount of nitrogen is incorporated into the water in the form of urea, that is mainly due to the sweating, secretion processes like sweat, urine and body oils actually incorporate a lot of nitrogen compounds, and they need to monitor continuously the breakpoint chlorination and ensure that it is free from pathogens beyond this. Here it's very important how much of chlorine should be added beyond the breakpoint chlorination. As per World Health Organization, they actually say that the minimum limit is 0.2 ppm or mg per liter of water, and the maximum limit is 5 ppm or 5 mg per liter. But although we say that 5 mg per liter is required, actually we generally don't go for 5 mg per liter because the taste and the odor of the water changes extremely. So they generally restrict to maximum of 2 mg per liter before distribution. Why this higher range of 2 mg per liter is maintained is the residual chlorine, because we don't know when the chlorine is added to the water and when it's going to the distribution point or to the homes. So the residual chlorine in the storage containers actually have a tendency to decay. So to ensure that it does not decay and still it acts as a disinfecting agent, they see that they maintain the level at 2 ppm. That is, beyond that, if you go, when high concentration of chlorine is present, it actually irritates the throat, lungs, and the gastrointestinal tract is affected. And sometimes it also affects, and a very high chlorine content will also lead to even bladder cancer, which is not preferable. So we need to identify the breakpoint chlorination and also maintain the residual chlorine so that it acts as a disinfectant, but it does not cause any side effects to our body. Thank you. This is all for the session. Let us meet in another session. Until then, bye-bye. Don't forget to subscribe. And please do drop your comments and press the like button if you like the video. Thank you. Bye-bye.